So I got the new MacBook Air as well as the new MacBook Pro. I thought a comparison would be cool. I mean, people are saying all kinds of positive things about these chips. It's really amazing. It's hard, right? What do? You go to the drawing board, you try to do your own silicon, and you try to replace a piece of Intel, which they've been the established brand in the space for so long. And then to get the initial impressions that are out there and the benchmarks and all the rest of it. I mean, it's pretty amazing, the numbers I'm seeing. So it got me pumped up enough to go pick both of these up. Now, the curious part here is how much overlap there is for these two devices. I get it. This one says Pro. It has the touch bar and all the rest of it. But from a performance perspective, they're really tight. And from a weight perspective, they're really tight. It's like a 0.2-pound difference. This would be a really confusing choice, I think, for a lot of buyers. I know some people, they want the thing to say Pro, and they might want to, I don't know, it's a slightly beefier build to it, but you can save some money and go with the Air. You don't have a fan. Oh, that would be the biggest difference. So you have active cooling on the MacBook Pro, which may avoid thermal throttling under a heavy load. However, I've seen some tests already on the Air, and it's looking pretty promising, even doing work for a while without a fan. And that speaks to what Apple's been able to do with the M1 chips. So as far as the spec is concerned, I think I got the higher end of the pre-configured spec, like not custom order or anything like that. So that means 8 GB memory to go with 512 SSD. You can see here 2.8 pounds for the Air and 3 pounds for the Pro. It's obviously, this is different if you go up to the 15-inch Pro, but that's a lot of overlap there if you're looking for a portable laptop. 13.3 inch display, Retina LED backlit, same resolution, 2560 by 1600. Two Thunderbolt ports, that's the same on both of them as well. Headphone jack, stereo, Touch ID, yeah, full size backlit keyboard. Yeah, that's the same, check. And both of these have the 8-core CPU and the 8-core GPU. So holy moly, what a tough choice. Well, that's what this video is about. Hopefully it makes that choice a little bit easier. So let's go ahead and unbox these, test them out, and see what I'm thinking. First up, let's do the Air. This is a little bit less expensive to get into at the baseline. So if you're looking for a budget model, actually in the past, I've recommended MacBook Airs to people for many, many years because of the price point, portability, and so forth. Then there was a bit of a keyboard fiasco that took place. I had a couple of them fail on me. Got some bad news. Bad news. Look at that. There, that's what it does. And I kind of stopped recommending them for a bit with that butterfly keyboard. Now Apple has modified that design and it's supposed to be better now. So hopefully that's the case. And I can start recommending this again for someone who's looking for an entry MacBook. However, what's a bit strange here, and I've played with so many laptops in this range size-wise, the Air is not very Air-like. I understand it's a high-performance laptop at this point, but it's right around 3 pounds. And I mean, I've looked at plenty of 14-inch laptops that are half a pound lighter than that or more. So it's not the lightest laptop in its class. However, what class is it even in? If I can boot up Final Cut Pro and export a 4K file, a 4K YouTube video in 2 minutes, that's a whole different class if that's the way this thing is behaving. All right, so space gray color, that's another difference between the two, the color options. If you want a gold one, for example, you're in Air territory. The unboxing experience is wonderfully simple, as you come to expect from Apple. We have a fairly long Type-C cable to go to the power brick. There's also a little bit of paperwork, as well as probably some Apple stickers. There they are. Space gray Apple stickers are in there. And this is the power brick. This might be another difference. Maybe this power brick is not as powerful as the one on the Pro. This is a 30-watt USB Type-C power adapter. So that's the Air. Now let's head over to the Pro. Okay, so that's the Pro, and while you really can't tell much of a difference, whether it's weight or form factor, they are so similar at first glance. Now, the Air, it tapers. This one is a little bit more symmetrical, but I do kind of like the taper on the Air when it comes to typing. because you have less of a ridge to overcome. I mean, this is nitpicking because all of these are so thin at this point. You can see the lip is very small to get over here. It's one of my favorite typing experiences. As far as the ports are concerned on the Pro, it's gonna be a headphone jack on the right side and two Thunderbolts on the other side. That's a bit of a letdown because previously on the Pro, you could get some extra connectivity and that just brings it closer to the Air now. Hopefully that's enough for most people, but that's what you're working with on the 13-inch Pro for the time being, two Type-C ports. In the package, you get the same Type-C connector, you get the same paperwork as well as your Apple stickers, and you do get a bigger power brick. As you can see here, it's a 61-watt power brick. What that likely means for you is a faster recharge on this particular unit. However, you are going to be carrying a less powerful power brick, so it's a bit of a trade-off there as well. All right, so open up the Pro and it boots up right away. You see how Apple does that? And it smells Apple fresh as well. So here you see the chiclet style keyboard, which is no longer using those butterfly key switches that were a little bit problematic on the previous models. And you still don't get a tremendous amount of travel, but if you're familiar with the older Apple laptop keyboards, it's kind of like that, but a little bit lower profile. Now, the other big difference here is the touch bar along the top, which I don't consider it a major differentiating factor between the two because I just don't use it that much. If you're the type of person that thinks you're gonna take tremendous use out of it, then that's another advantage for the Pro model. Fingerprint scanner's up here in the right-hand corner as well. That'll be the same for both. The body itself hasn't changed all that much from the previous version. So I've seen some teardowns and really it's almost like just swapping in the chip. The fan design is similar as well. I've heard that it sounds a bit different, but if you look at this thing with the bottom plate removed, you're basically looking at the previous generation MacBook with that new silicon in the inside. So that's kind of cool that they were able to just sub in their new component. However, it will be interesting to see as well what they're able to achieve when they design something from the ground up for the M1 chip specifically instead of fitting it into a previous design based on Intel. All right, so let's open up the Air and compare. It's just lift and go one-handed. That's some attention in the engineering and all the rest of it. The fit and finish of these things is no joke. I mean, I don't need to tell you now that they fixed the keyboard thing. And I think you could make the argument that for some people, the lack of touch bar could be an advantage because for me, when I reach for, say, audio settings, it will sometimes change dependent on the application that I'm in. I may see something different. It could be a bit finicky. In fact, in the past, they had the escape key inside of the touch bar and people hated it so much that they actually brought it out of the touch bar in the Pro models. There is an argument to having more physical keys, which is what the Air gives you for less. Speaker layout looks the same. Trackpad looks very similar. They may be ever so slightly different. They are. Trackpad is a little bit longer on the Pro. I set up these laptops. It's been, well, there's been a little bit of an ordeal, but not too bad. I had to find and track down this 16-inch. I have a pen as well. That's kind of, I tracked down the 16-inch MacBook Pro, which is the most recent professional MacBook from Apple. I did a number of edits on this system. I've edited on MacBook Pros for, I don't know, a lot of this whole YouTube thing. So I'm very familiar with them. We're looking at a 2.6 gigahertz, 6-core Intel Core i7, 16-inch from 2019. An expensive machine, far more expensive than either of these two new machines, running on Intel, dedicated graphics. Of course, you have a fan in there as well. We're gonna see if the fan kicks up, how it behaves and what it sounds like. Mo put together a nice little timeline here. 1 minute edit on Final Cut Pro, a number of clips from a Sony A7S III. That codec in some circumstances can be a bit of a nightmare for editing software at higher resolutions. And then there's been some effects applied, some stabilization, couple of titles, some music. And so this is meant to simulate a workflow. Well, it actually is a workflow. This is what we would do. It's what I would do. Export a video clip, upload a video clip. This is where this M1 stuff gets exciting because if I can be close performance-wise to this unit on the far right, the expensive Pro model 16-inch with these devices on the left with Apple's silicon at a starting price of around $1,000 US, well, that's a significant leap. All right, so this is the Apple device's computer setting in 4K, H.264 faster encode setting 3840 by 2160 across all three units. Also, software is exact across the board here. We're talking about the latest Final Cut. We're talking about the latest Mac OS. 3, 2, 1. So we're not quite at real-time speed right now. If that number stays, if it remains at that pace, we're a little slower than real-time speed. All right, so just under a minute 30, 1 minute 28, 35 on the big old MacBook Pro. Now we're gonna switch over to the MacBook Air. 3, 2, 1. Oh, baby. Now you understand why people are excited. This is a MacBook Air. This is a fanless design. And look at this. So, oh my goodness gracious. Would you look at this? It is completed right now. Right now. 44 seconds. You're talking about a MacBook Air doing this in half the time. That is a huge improvement over the previous generation. Let's see if the MacBook Pro is any different. The new MacBook Pro, the 13-inch. Now this one as well has an active fan in it. Presumably, if you were doing really long exports and the system started to heat up, this one could, I mean, at least theoretically, maintain its performance over a longer period of time when compared to the Air. So that's worth considering, although the starting price is a bit higher on this particular model and it's a little bit heavier, barely. 3, 2, 1. Oh, like barely, it's probably just my tap. After all, the spec sheet is the same and we're not pushing them so hard that the fans need to turn on or that you would have a thermal issue. So you can expect these to essentially perform the same. And that actually, it kind of speaks to what I was saying earlier about these two devices, the new M1 models. It speaks to this difficulty in figuring out what you should select, if you should save your money and just get the Air, depending on what type of tasks you do, or if you feel like you need the Pro. But they have a lot more in common than they do different. I will say I noticed that the display on the 13-inch Pro is maybe ever so slightly brighter than on the Air. In fact, I feel like this display on the 13-inch Pro is even maybe slightly brighter than the 16-inch. I didn't even notice it. It wasn't enough for me to notice until I had them side by side, but it's a tough choice. This starts at $999. This starts $300 more. I think the MacBook Air is gonna be a serious recommendation for me at the moment for anybody who works in video, for anybody who works in Final Cut Pro, to have a sub 3-pound package that's gonna export a 1 minute 4K video in a heavy codec in better than real time. I mean, what a time to be alive, 2020, things are happening. Shout out to Apple. I'm impressed. I saw it now in real life and in real time. It's a new M1 MacBook Pro 13 and the new M1 MacBook Air 13.